Hello students, to continue with the topic of pain management, I will start today with the nursing assessment of pain. When a patient is in pain, what all things we have to check or assess so that accordingly we can plan for the treatment or intervention. So in the assessment part, we have to ask the history. In that, we have to measure the characteristics of pain. How the pain is characterized, there are 3 or 4 points in which you can describe a particular pain. First is onset and duration. That means how the pain began. Was it gradual or sudden pain had occurred? When it began, how long it lasted, how often the pain occurs. Then the duration, for how many days the pain is there. Then second assessment or the second characteristic will be location of the pain. Ask the patient where he is feeling pain. And in the history part, you have to write the anatomical landmarks to describe the location. In location, you will also write about the referred, deep, superficial or radiating. You will ask the patient whether the pain is superficial or very deep, or pain is radiating to some other body parts. Then next, the term referred pain means pain is felt in unaffected area, as no pain receptors in the affected organ are present. For example, if a pain is there due to kidney stone, pain will be felt in the groin, pain of the angina, that means in the heart due to insufficient blood supply. When chest pain occurs, pain will sometimes radiate to shoulders, jaw, hand, etc. That is referred pain. The actual area will not be affected. That is referred pain. Then the next characteristics of pain will be intensity. We have to write about intensity of the pain. Intensity, in that we have to write like this, that patient is having mild pain, moderate pain, very severe pain, intolerable pain. These terms can be used when you are writing the history related to the characteristics of pain. Now I will show the intensity can be measured by using a scale. This is visual analog scale. At one end it is written as 0, other end the 100. 100 means worst for pain imaginable, 0 means no pain at all. So the patient will point the finger on the scale and you can make an assessment that whether the pain is mild, moderate or severe. Then happy face, sad face scale. This is also another type of scale. You can ask the patient about the intensity by showing this type of scale. This is also a happy and sad face scale. So these are different type of scales to measure the intensity. So third characteristic is intensity of pain. Then next characteristics is pain pattern. Pain pattern is the factors which increase or decrease the pain. Activities or movement which causes pain. Any particular time of day when pain occurs. And also whether the pain is intermittent and whether it is constant. Constant means throughout the day the patient feels pain. And intermittent means during the daytime there are pain-free periods, as well as there are periods in which there is lot of pain experienced by the patient. Then next is relief measures. This is the next characteristics you have to ask. How the pain is relieved, like changing the position, meditating, praying, applying the heat or cold, or by rubbing, rocking, massaging, etc. these are the relief measures which the patient is taking. Then next, characteristics of pain. In the assessment part, we have to ask about the concomitant symptoms. Symptoms associated with the pain, like when pain occurs, there is sensation of nausea, headache, dizziness, increased sense of urination, constipation, etc. So you have to write the concomitant symptoms also. Then effect of the pain on the patient, how the pain has affected the life, like loss of control, loneliness, disability, exhaustion, and impaired quality of life. Now next is the behavioral indicators of the effect of pain. Next is the behavioral indicators of effect of pain. That means the patient, in some patients who are confused, who do not report properly the characteristics of pain, for example very young child or a very old person, or a person who is not able to speak, there is language difficulty, or speaks a foreign language, aphasia is there. In those cases we have to understand the behavioral cues related to pain. For example, like patient is moaning, patient is crying, gasping, grunting, that means the patient is in pain. Then see the facial expression of the patient. This is also behavioral indicators, like grimace, clenched teeth, wrinkled forehead, tightly closed or widely opened eyes or mouth, lip biting, etc. So these are the behavioral indicators. Next behavioral indicator will be the body movement, like he is very restless or he is immobilized, not able to move because of pain. Muscle tension will be increased hand and body movements, pacing activities. These are behavioral indicators. Then in social interaction, this is also a type of behavioral indicator. There is reduced attention span, focus on the pain relieving activities, avoiding people, avoiding conversation, etc. After assessment, there will be formulation of nursing diagnosis. So some of the common nursing diagnoses which are used for a patient in pain will be, the examples are written: acute pain related to childbirth, activity intolerance related to pain, anxiety related to unrelieved pain, ineffective coping related to chronic pain, fatigue related to chronic pain, fear related to chronic pain, hopelessness related to cancer pain, impaired physical mobility related to pain, imbalanced nutrition related to reduced intake due to pain, insomnia related to pain, powerlessness related to chronic pain, chronic self-esteem, low self-esteem, etc. So these are some of the probable nursing diagnoses of a patient who is in pain. So accordingly we have to plan. In plan we have to first set the priorities, that means which is most important should be implemented first. Also the pain management requires teamwork and collaboration. Now in the implementation, all the patients with pain require an individualized approach, and you will try to use different type of pain relief measures. It should not be only limited to drugs, but other type of measures are also used to relieve pain. Keep an open mind while treating pain. Educate the client about pain. So in implementation part, there are different type of interventions which are used to relieve pain. In that, first I will tell about the non-pharmacological methods, that means without drugs, how the pain sensation is reduced. The pain sensation can be reduced by stimulating the person's skin to reduce pain. When you are rubbing the skin or massaging the skin, the A beta fibers are stimulated, and this will reduce the or inhibit the transmission of pain to the brain. So the patient less pain impulse or pain sensation will be carried to the brain. Accordingly, the patient will feel less pain. So cutaneous stimulation means stimulating the patient's skin. How you will stimulate? By giving a massage, by warm bath to the giving warm bath to the patient. Hot applications and cold applications equally they will. This is also a form of cutaneous stimulation. Then transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. So I will explain one by one. First is massage. Massage the purpose is to reduce the physical and mental tension. Physical and mental relaxation is achieved. Then pain is reduced. The pain medications are more effectively they are more effective when they are used with massage. Then sleep and comfort is also enhanced. Massage can be done on any part of the body like back or hands or shoulders, neck, arms. So circular motion is used while moving upward, and large muscles should be used for massage. The feet are also massaged by using gliding motion from heel to toe. So this is one form of cutaneous stimulation. Next is TENS, transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. That means with the help of electricity, the cutaneous fibers are stimulated, or buzzing sensation will be there, and the patient will experience less pain. It involves stimulation of nerves beneath the skin with a mild electrical current passed through the external electrodes. So TENS unit consists of a battery powered transmitter, lead wires and electrodes. Electrodes are placed directly over the site of the pain or near the site of the pain. Hairs should be removed before placing the electrodes for better conduction of electricity. The patient will feel tingling or buzzing sensation and there will be pain relief. So this is the TENS machine. In the diagram, the brown colored square patches, these are all electrodes which are placed over the skin. This is the example picture which shows how the electrodes are placed over the back, used for back pain. TENS machine is used for back pain. Then next is hot and cold application, another type of cutaneous stimulation. Moist heat is used for the relieving the pain of arthritis. Then cold application, it is very important for any type of acute injury, acute inflammation, any acute pain, any tooth and mouth pain which is acute. In that, cold application reduces the pain by numbing that site. And dry heat, it is also a form of hot application. It is in the form of heating pads, diathermy, etc., which is used to reduce pain. So these are the cutaneous stimulation. After cutaneous stimulation, another non-pharmacologic method is relaxation and guided imagery. Relaxation means we have to the patient should be mentally and physically free from any type of tension or stress. And by relaxation, when we are measuring the parameters like pulse, BP, respiration, this will be reduced. The techniques of relaxation are meditation, yoga, guided imagery and progressive relaxation exercise. And it is specially useful for chronic pain. For relaxation exercises, client's participation and cooperation is very much required. In acute pain, relaxation exercise is not so effective. In guided imagery, this is also a form of relaxation. Client creates an image in the mind concentrate on that image and gradually become less aware of pain. For example, an image of a flowing river or a image of a quiet village, these will actually actually create calmness in the brain, and ultimately the patient will feel more relaxed. So guided imagery means an image which is used to soothe out the patient. Then next form of non-pharmacological method is distraction. Distraction means reduce the attention. It is only useful for a very short duration when a person will ignore or become unaware of pain. And next type of non-pharmacological method to reduce pain is music. Music treats acute pain as well as chronic pain, stress, anxiety and depression. It diverts the patient's attention. Music therapy uses all kind of music. It creates relaxation response. Music produces altered state of consciousness through sound, silence, space and time. So this is also one of the method to reduce pain. Then next is biofeedback. Biofeedback means it is a type of behavioral therapy that involves giving the individual information about the physiological responses and ways to exercise voluntary control over those responses. That means in some instance, for example, patient who are suffering from migraine, in that some electrodes are placed over the head, over the temple, and this will measure the skin tension. When the patient is in pain, they will measure the skin tension, which is seen on the screen as a graph, and client will see the changes in the graph machine. So the client will try to relax so that the changes in the graph will be minimum. So the change in the behavior by doing some relaxation exercise is a type of biofeedback therapy. That means we are taking feedback from our physiological responses, and accordingly we are trying to relax ourselves by doing some relaxation exercise, meditation, etc., to reduce the pain response. Then next is herbal therapy. Herbals, although scientific evidence is less regarding the use of herbals, but some people say use of ginseng, gingko biloba, garlic, etc. Can reduce pain. Now next is in the hospital, for a patient who is admitted in the hospital, all the patients are in distress. So the nursing responsibility to make a patient comfortable are as follows. These are given below. This is also some interventions to reduce pain or reduce discomfort, you can say. So our nursing responsibility when a patient is admitted in the hospital, we have to see that to control the painful stimulus, we have to tighten and smooth wrinkled bed linen. The bed linen should be smooth, no wrinkles should be there. Position the patient, avoid lying on the tubing, IV tubing or catheters, etc. Any tight bandages should be loosened, constrictive bandages should not be there. Wet dressings, wet linen should be immediately changed, and position the patient in anatomical alignment. This is very important. Then when you are giving hot and cold applications, check the temperature, especially for the hot applications. Lift the patient in the bed, do not pull the patient. Position the patient correctly on the bedpan and don't be too harsh when you are removing the bedpan. Do not pull the bedpan from under the patient's bed. Then avoid exposing the skin or mucous membrane to the irritant. Irritants can be the drainage, stool, urine, etc. Then keep the patients clean, dry and turned. Prevent urinary retention by keeping the Foley's catheter patent. There should not be any block in the Foley's catheter. Prevent constipation of the patient by giving adequate fluid, diet, laxative if it is required. So these are the non-pharmacological methods to reduce pain and discomfort. Now I will talk about the drugs which are used for pain relief. To reduce pain, analgesics are used. These are classified into non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and opioid analgesics. And adjuvants are some other drugs which are added. They are not actually analgesics, but they will help to reduce anxiety, depression and other symptoms related to pain. So these are called as adjuvant. NSAIDs has already been discussed in the pharmacology class. NSAIDs are safe, quite safe. They act on peripheral receptors, can be used for short periods. They do not cause depression of the central nervous system, do not depress the bowel and bladder function. So this is the advantage of NSAIDs. Disadvantage is that if it is used for a very long time, GI bleeding can occur, renal toxicity occurs, hepatotoxicity occurs. Examples are ibuprofen, naproxen, indomethacin, rofecoxib. There are other NSAIDs available also. Then opioid analgesics. It is used for moderate pain or very severe pain, especially post-operative pain or very severe pain, opioids are used. These are acting on the higher centers of the brain and spinal cord by binding with opiate receptors, modifying the perception of the pain, reduces anxiety and fear, and induces sleep even in the presence of severe pain. The side effects of opioid are nausea, vomiting, constipation. This is a common side effect. Altered mental process, because they will cause CNS depression. Example of narcotic analgesics or opioid analgesics are morphine, fentanyl, meperidine, pethidine, pentazocine and tramadol. So these are some of the opioid analgesics. Now let us see the adjuvants. The adjuvants are drugs used to treat conditions other than pain and also have analgesic properties. For example, tricyclic antidepressants, anticonvulsants, infusional lidocaine, corticosteroid, bisphosphonate, calcitonin, sedative, anti-anxiety drugs, muscle relaxants. Next pharmacological methods will be the use of anesthetics. First is topical analgesia. Topical analgesics means the anesthetic drugs are rubbed over the skin. That is topical analgesia. It is used in some cases to reduce pain. Then local anesthetics. Local anesthetics means a particular area is anesthetized so that the patient does not feel pain, especially done for certain procedures. When you are doing certain surgical procedures, local anesthesia is required. So LA, that means local anesthesia, actually they are blocking the sensory function, motor function, autonomic functions of that particular area. So no pain sensation will be felt by the patient. Side effects are sometimes seen on using the local anesthesia, like itching or burning of the skin, rash can be seen. Next application of anesthesia is the regional anesthesia. After local anesthesia, regional anesthesia. It is also a method to reduce pain and it is specially done for a painful procedure like surgery, cesarean section, during childbirth. These are, in these cases, regional anesthesia are used. It is the injection of the local anesthetic to block a group of sensory nerve fibers. Tissues are anesthetized layer by layer as the surgeon introduces the agent into the deeper structures of the body. The kinds of regional anesthesia are epidural, spinal and pudendal. Now quickly we will see the nursing care of a patient receiving spinal or epidural analgesia. We have to explain the patient that when spinal or epidural analgesia is given, numbness, tingling sensation is common. Patient will lose all the sensory function, bowel, bladder functions are also lost. Monitor for the respiratory depression when the patient has received spinal anesthesia. Monitor vital signs. Protect the patient from injury until full sensory and motor function returns. Avoid application of heat and cold to the numb areas. Maintain urinary and bowel function. Assess for bowel and bladder distension when the patients are under spinal and epidural anesthesia. When all these measures fail, then sometimes the nerve roots are damaged. They are totally ablated. For example, chordotomy, rhizotomy, thalamotomy, radio frequency ablation, cryo ablation. Cryo means with a very low temperature is used to destroy or freeze the nerve roots. Now it is seen that certain procedures causes pain in the critical care in the ICU patients, like when you are turning the patient, when you are removing the drain, wound drains, when you are doing tracheal suctioning, when you are removing a femoral catheter, when you are placing a central line, when you are changing the dressings. So in all these procedures, pre-medication for pain should be given so that patient can cooperate more fully for relieving pain. Now for the cancer pain, this is the WHO which has given a step ladder pattern to manage cancer pain. For in step one, when there is persistent pain or increasing pain, first we will start with non-opioid as well as adjuvants are sometimes used, plus minus adjuvant, that means sometimes it is used, sometimes not. When the pain increases, the second part is use opioid. Mild opioids will be used, mild to moderate pain, the second step ladder pattern. In that interventions, opioids are used, also non-opioid are used and adjuvants are used sometimes. And the third, in that for very severe, moderate to severe pain, opioids will be given along with non-opioid analgesics are also given, adjuvants are also given. So this is the WHO three-step approach to manage cancer pain. So this is all about the pain and its management. Hope you have understood. If there is any questions, you can ask. So thank you, students.